Good evening and welcome to our annual celebration of Latin School. No one could have predicted the events of 2020 and the subsequent changes in our lives. With that in mind, we have crafted a special video program. You will hear from Head of School, Rachel Skerritt, faculty members and students, how Latin School is adapting in these challenging times. Music will permeate the rest of the evening as we positively celebrate the immeasurable contributions of Program Director for Visual and Performing Arts, Paul Pitts, class of 1973. Our evening will culminate with the 2020 Distinguished Graduate of the Year, Prince Charles Alexander, class of 1975, who created an enduring and successful career in the music industry. A 385-year-old school does not thrive without fortitude, courage, vision, and intelligence of its community. It is with this vibrancy, resilience, and strength in mind that we launch into this year's celebration.
We're social beings. We're not going to be healthy unless we socialize. We know this. We must understand that that connection is essential for health.
I could have never imagined that we'd be in this situation, but who could have? It's hard to speak for the students, but I think that what they would say is most difficult is the lack of socialization in person between one another. I think that our faculty members have done a tremendous job of bringing the content through Zoom, believe it or not. But what you can't get is just that impromptu moment of when students push their desks together in a class and get to talk about something in small groups, or when, you know, you walk out of the class and you walk down the hallway to your next class and you chat about what's going on in the world or what you're doing after school. You know, those unpredictable moments, those just really informal conversations that become kind of the glue to your day are really hard to replicate virtually, and I think students really miss those touch points.
My name is Janice Rodriguez Andujar.
I'm Isla Schillen.
My name is Philippe Madrona.
My name is Joe Jackson.
My name is Nerla Otino.
Hello, my name is Sarah.
Something you might not know about me is I am a stepper.
I'm an artist.
I wasn't born in the United States.
My favorite class is math.
I like to go hiking in various states.
Hardest part for the kid is just not being able to do the things that they love. Latin School, it's the academic pinnacle of the city, of the state, and our kids work hard in the classroom, and you know, they're missing that social interaction with their friends, but we all need to be safe during this time. But once in a non-COVID or reduced COVID world, they need the values that you learn. It's not about wins and losses. It's the values you learn: teamwork, camaraderie, accountability, responsibility, leadership. You know, those are Latin School values.
It's sort of hard to keep going every day.
Everyone is optimistic that we'll be able to go back to in-person school soon, but we all do know that there is a risk to it.
Going remotely and for possibly maybe the entire school year is difficult.
Because it's online, you don't get that same connection.
We don't get to really see our teachers and physically interact with them.
Being virtually in school has been hard for a lot of people, just not being in the building, not seeing their friends, not walking in the halls, not having that usual environment that they're in.
It sounds very cliche, but I miss going to school every day. You know, just getting up and walking into a building seems like heaven right now, and I can't wait to return to it.
I miss the clubs a lot, and I miss the after-school space of being able to walk down the halls and seeing friends and saying hi and just giving a small hug and waving goodbye at the end of the day.
This is tough on everybody's emotional, mental health and sanity. I think it's just not being able to come together and support each other in person and learning how to do that without feeling isolated.
Going to school right now is very difficult, especially due to the pandemic. However, I think BLS has maintained its engagement through just having its clubs still participate and have meetings and just also still have wonderful discussions in class. So even though we are virtual, I still feel a part of the BLS community.
This year, the teachers have been trying to make the online school feel a little bit more normal. Specifically, my English teacher at the beginning of class every day gives 5 minutes for people to talk about how their day has been going, current events that have been happening, and whatever, just to make people feel more like they're in a classroom.
Everything is extremely structured. You can tell, as a parent, you can tell that doesn't happen by chance. It definitely went through very thorough planning and a lot of time from the teachers.
I think it's really important for us to do school as much as we possibly can within the constraints that we've been given, because that sense of routine, that sense of normalcy, that touch point, it really is something that I think is propelling us through this difficult time.
It's been really important to give students space to process what's going on, and I think the school has done a really good job of trying to do that.
My teacher really feels like a friend as well as a figure of authority. She tells us, you know, just keep your mics off. We're having a conversation. You don't need to unmute yourself every time you want to speak.
They seem very passionate about like their teaching, and it definitely carries over with their work, and I can definitely vibe with that.
Even though we can't see each other, I definitely feel the senior class officers trying to bond everyone together and create events. I've been definitely speaking out to more of my classmates deliberately because I have to find them now.
We spend a lot of time thinking about how to not just maintain a sense of community, but to improve it during this time. We've been pushed to become more innovative and carve out intentional space for students to be able to share, for students and staff to be able to engage with one another.
I did feel like scared and anxious at some point, but I had the opportunity to speak out by creating a petition throughout the pandemic with some of my peers, and that really grew me as a person because I was able to find my voice during this like time of anxiousness and such.
I think I found common ground with other people. Like I started talking with a couple of the students there, a couple of other BZ in fact. I was able to talk with them, I was able to communicate with them, and I was able to like just socialize. Like we were like, hey, we're both new here. We don't know much today. Let's connect.
I feel like my friends are kind of a community for me, and also my teachers, because they're really helpful and supportive of like everything that I choose to do.
We are in a unique position to give perspective and lens and to understand there is tomorrow. So we prepare and support today, but we also consistently move to the next step, which is tomorrow. And so that balance is an essential one for, of course, you know, health and progress.
I love BLS because it's a big community that makes us feel small. There are so many people involved, all the parents, all the students, friends of the family and the administrators, but we all feel connected.
I think this has made us appreciate having this community and going to school and just being there with our friends and just walking the halls and things like that.
I just feel really fortunate to be part of a community of young people who are rising to the occasion, showing tremendous flexibility and resilience, and really collaborating to try to make this work for us.
BLS is a place where amazing learning happens for our students. It's a place where students come together, where they support each other. It's a group of students and a student body that's really inspiring.
This year specifically has shifted how I think about the world. I've really been thinking more about the politics and like inequalities in our world that have been shown through the different effects of coronavirus on different neighborhoods, different countries.
It's kind of really opened my eyes, and I've like really started thinking in different ways because I've had more time to myself to kind of like find myself.
Before the pandemic, it was definitely a little more narrow-minded, I could almost say, but with all this incoming news about just the elections as well as Black Lives Matter, I'm becoming more aware and educated on different issues all around the nation.
You know, I say to faculty members all the time, and they wholeheartedly agree, that our young people are so much more politically and socially aware and conscious than we were at their age. And that is both extremely admirable and can also be very painful during these difficult days. And we have certainly seen that watching students processing dual pandemics with COVID-19 and our nation's racial reckoning that's been taking place over the last several months.
We're stronger for those things which challenge us. These aren't just trite statements, they're in fact true statements.
I think our kids are really wonderful and they're so resilient, and I feel excited to see who these people will become, like where they'll be as adults and how these lessons will have impacted their lives.
It amazes me every day what our kids have the ability to do, and sad that we're in this position, but they're persevering, they're resilient, they're tough. They're gonna get through this.
As hard as school is, I think it is the best option. And so I'm really thankful that I'm still in school, that we're not just saying, you know, put a pause in school.
I feel hopeful, and I know how wonderful and passionate and excited our students are. And I know they're gonna be okay, so.
Here we go, we're gonna get it. BLS in the house, let's get it.
Paul kind of has a tough exterior, but a soft interior.
It's definitely, I think, a unique teaching style sometimes. You know, there's yelling and there's rambunctiousness. You know, you might think he's mad, but it's like, no, he's not mad. He's just getting his point across.
Feisty, funny, compassionate. I think feisty is my favorite. Feisty.
He's just a really dynamic person, and I mean that musically, and I mean that as a personality too. So I think that a lot of that shaped my teaching too, and I've taken on some of those little habits as well.
Mr. Pitts was very competitive. Someone makes a mistake, and he'd call it out, kind of James Brown style.
Even when you fish, if he caught more than you, which you always like to try, he was happy.
I feel as if Paul and I have really vibed on getting very excited about song selections and production. And, you know, he lives and breathes his work.
Back in early 90s when I first started teaching at Latin School, I remember music night was only one night in the springtime. Then enter Paul Pitts, and he was like a whirlwind.
It was an attitude change. When I first got there, music didn't meet every day, and it didn't count for your GPA, and we didn't see the kids all the time, and they had sections, but they were called advanced classes, and your kids didn't have to come, and I thought, well, that's not very good. No, that you have to come to that class. I said, this is the Latin school, you're a senior, and you don't have to come to class? Uh-uh.
If you could have seen what he would do to get his jazz band into a competition, and how he would take the seats out of his van, load all of the kids' instruments into his van. The two of us would drive over, and then we'd get all the kids and we'd unload the van. And he was just so dedicated and passionate.
Mr. Pitts is wonderfully charismatic. He is dramatic. He is so in love with music and about making you feel something with the music that he directs and creates. And he's moved by music so much. You know, I've seen him cry listening to pieces, and you can tell how much, like, music is just his soul. It's not a job for him. It's his way of life.
It's not necessarily the teacher and the student mindset. It's that we're doing this together. We're creating together.
I could talk to you till you're blue in the face, but that's not gonna get it done. I'm gonna show you. We're not gonna change the schedule. I'm just gonna work my buns off here. I'm gonna work hard, the kids are gonna work hard, and we're gonna get better. And after a few years, people started to see the light. The band got better, the kids could play better. We played more in tune, we played harder repertoire.
I think about the way he sits while he's listening, the lean back when he's really, really interpreting and listening to a band. I think about his amazing attention to detail. I think about how he really, really sets a tone that makes it really fun and a little quirky for all of the ensembles that I've seen, that I've been a part of with him.
I fell in love with learning how to play, and I really do think that is the essence of Paul Pitts.
To me, the goal is to get them to love music. We have had kids gone on full scholarships to Berkeley and other schools in music, but my goal is, you know, I try to share the love. If you love music, you know, if it's hip hop, if it's funk, if it's rock, if it's classical, whatever it is, if you're really into it, it brings you great joy. And try to share that joy. And it seems to have worked.
Mr. Pitts taught me how to enjoy music and what it feels like to actually have those moments, you know, that solo that you took and really digging in, right?
as a student who went to Berkeley and started learning more about production and sort of went on the electronic side, I was actually this year teaching him how to work on some software and giving tips. And it made me feel like I kind of graduated in a different sort of way. It made me feel like I was part of a community, and there's still more we can learn from each other.
I love Louis Armstrong. What a wonderful world. That's a viewpoint, it's, you know, and it's the one with in 1969 where Louis Armstrong says, you know, kids today say with all the wars and strife and starvation, how can the world be beautiful? And he says, you just got to give it a chance. If you're an optimist, you can be disappointed, but it's just a better way to go. And I'm optimistic. I love Mingus because I like his political statement. We're doing Fables of Fables. I love Leonard Bernstein. That was probably the high point of my career, I think. Would the band ever be good enough to play Bernstein? We actually played Bernstein's music on stage at Symphony Hall. It was like, you know, a religious experience. I was a kid and I put my hand on the rail, you know, like the new conductor does, but I think I was the only one who got the joke. But it was just so much fun. The pictures from that are just stellar. It was really fantastic. So I come into school, listen to music, Sherry Lewis would be like, what are you doing, Pitts? You know, I'd just be jumping with the music, you know, because I'd be in a good mood.
The legacy of Paul Pitts at Boston Latin School is providing the opportunities for students to study music, to study theater, to study visual arts in any way, shape, or form that they can.
You can get angry at each other, you can have an argument, but then you get over it, or you come to a conclusion and then it's over. You know, there's no hurt feelings or anything, and it's always, you can voice your opinion and respect that, and it's just a wonderful relationship that you can have with someone.
I sat down and I auditioned. Then the person who is auditioning me,
they say, oh, what high school did you go to?
And I said, Boston Latin School.
And they know I'm a musician, so they say,
you're one of Paul Pitts's.
You must know Mr. Pitts. And
that phrase has followed me my entire life.
It just shows how well-known and how his reputation really precedes him.
If I were to pick one person who I say had a profound impact on Latin School, Paul Pitts would be at the top of that list.
He gave the space, he gave the time, he gave the dedication, the energy to making sure that any person, any student who wanted to be involved could be involved.
He's really shaped the ability of making sure that students are engaged in the music, you know, and really care about what they're creating.
You had to see him directing his jazz band. You'd see his back and you'd see him moving his hands and swinging back and forth a little bit. And when the piece was over, he would turn around and face the audience and give a little bow. And you could tell that there was just this incredible pride in what had just happened.
The fact that he married that Boston Latin School sense of excellence to the music program, and at the same time creating beautiful music for the students who just will have this as a memory. It will hopefully continue with students like myself that he had.
My yearbook quote was, do what you like. The tour was like, do what you like, do what you like, do what you like. So unbeknownst to me, my daughter, you know, whatever, 20, 30 years later, she had the same quote in her yearbook and we didn't even talk about it. If you could do what you like, you'd never work a day in your life. You know, that's it.
So I get into Boston Latin, I'm 11 years old, and there's a sign that says, learn music. Either get the trumpet or the clarinet. So I went home and asked my mom, I want to play music, I want to be the Renaissance man. She said, well, you're not bringing a trumpet into this house, they're too loud. So my fate was sealed. It was Roland G. Young, who was the music instructor, and Roland said, this is the clarinet, this is where you put your fingers, now blow. And I blew, and immediately, there was a connection.
Some folks have it and some do not. Don't think the ball. When the people know you have it, or you're really high. Don't think the ball. They're gonna play this record everywhere.
I love this guy. Oh my gosh.
And he had the leotards on. And I would put Vaseline all over his torso. And then we'd do glitter, you know. On it, and you know, we'd have fun.
First of all, I want that body back. I'm about 25 years old. Hip hop is exploding on the scene, but I was immersed in funk. Rahsaan Roland Kirk was playing at Paul's Mall, and he had this instrument called the Lyricon. It's a wind synthesizer. And I was thinking to myself, I could take that and do something like Bootsy Collins did with his bass.
And I remember we were putting together money, and I was like, okay, I'll give you something, you know, to go towards buying that, you know. And we got that Lyricon, and that was a whole nother dimension.
At Dance Soteria, the person who happened to be playing that night was Madonna and Defunct and Prince Charles Alexander. And so Charles was on stage with a three-piece band playing the Lyricon. So it was very impressive to hear him play.
Charles is definitely a visionary. Whatever Charles wants to do, he does it. He learns what has to be done, right? Okay, I'd like to do this. Okay, what does that require? Okay, it requires that, then he executes it. So he wanted to be a band leader, have his own band. So he started his own band, he gets a record deal, he gets a manager, he tours all over the world. Okay, he executes. Charles is not a singer, but he fronts a band, you know, and does his thing, and it's cool. Everybody digs it, you know. You know,
because of the curiosity that had been embedded in me in my Boston Latin experience, I had the potential to be somebody that could, you know, do languages, do music, do sports, art, culture, science. I think that was fostered in me, walking in the door at Boston Latin and look to the left and look to the right and somebody won't be here and, you know, look at the faces around the hall. That 25-year-old Charles Alexander that became Prince Charles had a determination. Something was planted in him along the journey where just couldn't be stopped. And I have this saying now, if I can stop you from doing something, then you didn't want it bad enough.
Our little prince, and it's ironic how years later he took on that moniker of Prince Charles, but he was always our prince. Before punk funk and city beat band, he was our Prince Charles, you know.
Well, what's interesting about Prince Charles, and I call him Prince Charles now because everybody calls him Prince Charles. I was born here. Obviously, I would know of everybody on the news scene. Charles comes here in the early 80s. Within a few years, Charles knows everybody I know.
I heard Rapper's Delight. I thought it was the stupidest thing I ever heard. I was like, this is a joke. There's three guys talking on a record. How important can this record be? Why is everybody gravitating toward this record? If it was important, I needed to have my back covered. So I went in and did a rap on a song called Tight Jeans. You know, Prince Charles on the case from 9 till 2. I'm looking for a girl who looks just like you. Skin tight jeans, fitting just right. Let's party, girl, to the early light. I'll rap to you, I'll rap to your friends, and take you both home when the party ends. Those jeans you're wearing are out of sight, but you can't sit down because it fit too tight. Anyway.
I think when you first look at Charles, it's funny to look at somebody in their own beginning period of their life. Charles is Prince Charles and the City Beat Band, right? So if you go to Prince Charles and the City Beat Band, you don't get any clue that you're going to see Prince Charles Alexander.
I remember being at Madison Square Garden, Prince Charles and the City Beat Band, you know, front and center, my name in big lights. And I had a meltdown. I was sitting there looking into space, looking into the future. Living for the spotlight means I got to chase another hit record and chase another hit record and chase another hit record. Okay, let's go behind the scenes so that we can have a consistent musical life and we can take and infuse into some of the newer voices.
So he goes to school, and then over time becomes one of the biggest engineers in New York City, doing the pumping out all those records with Bad Boy and doing different things. And, you know, it's okay, he came up with a plan. He saw what he needed to do, and he did it.
He's very direct. You know, he gets straight to the work as far as the music is concerned. He is very good at producing the music and the way it's supposed to be properly done.
I looked at him and I said, what are you doing here? You know, like, why are you doing engineering? And to make a long story short, you know, the music industry was already, even at that time, doing a transition. So he took his skill of what he knew about electronics, because he, He's a mathematical brain. We became friends, we became partners, we became co-producers, we became co-writers. We created, I think, a whole new way for the quote-unquote the multi-centric, multifaceted musician to do records. And at the same time, we did all of those records with Mary J. Blige and Puff Daddy and everybody in hip hop. We did it.
Charles has garnered a lot of respect in the music industry. Again, as one of the early creators involved with hip hop, he has that badge of honor. He was there when it was being developed.
Charles is a 4 Grammy winner. He had one in Europe going around working with Duran Duran. And then he had 3 here in the United States for doing the family album with Puff Daddy then, but P. Diddy, and he did the Happy album with Mary J. Blige.
There was a point, there wasn't a CD that had been produced that when you looked at the liner notes, Prince Charles Alexander.
The proof is in the pudding. Not only look at his records, not only look at his stature, but look at how he affects people after they do a project with him. And that could be anywhere, anybody from Aretha Franklin to people in gospel, people in jazz. He's a musician's musician. He's a sound man's sound man.
I see a Mix magazine cover article, 1999. It was an article about Mary J. Blige and Elton John collaborating. And it featured an engineer, a black recording engineer, which I hadn't really seen many of. And so I reached out to Charles on behalf of Berkeley to get him to come and share his experience. And he came to visit Berkeley and was stellar and really knocked the kids out.
We already have the Grammys. We already got the platinum records. It's very redundant. And I thought about athletes. When you're a great athlete, what do you do later on in life? You go to a college and you coach the next generation. So I said, well, what does that look like for me? And where does that happen?
And I kept knocking, and he kept kind of going, well, I don't know, maybe. And then finally, in 2004, I knocked again, and he was ready. And he made the move, and they hired him.
He wanted to be going to academia. Okay, what do I have to do? He gets his master's. He's at one of the most reputable music schools in the world, not in the country, in the world, at Berkeley.
What are Charles' greatest characteristics? There's so many. Let's start with the not insignificant fact that he was a performer. Charles likes a crowd, and he likes the love. I think that's a big motivator for him. With any performer, there's a certain magic and a synergy that comes from the audience.
Some of my students are Charlie Puth, Maggie Rogers from NYU, because I taught at NYU also, and others who are just, you know, proliferating the music industry, and I feel that's my rebirth. And I tell all of them when they finish my classes, I say, when you're standing up there getting your Grammy, you better give me a shout out. And that's how I close all my classes.
Charles and I actually grew up together. We knew each other from very young. We played Little League Baseball together for a team called the Castle Square Royals. We were quite a good team. We won 2 championships, and then he and I continued to be friends through the rest of our time. Grew up in the Cathedral Project. I grew up in Castle Square.
I think the best way to describe Charles would be the thing that he used to do in band that used to drive us nuts. He would take his clarinet, and he would somehow get the reed to make this profane, horrifying squeal that would go up and up pitches to the point where dogs would start barking. And we would all just say, Charles, cut it out. Knock it off. Stop doing that. Fast forward 10 years later, we're at a gig at a club playing our jazz. And he ends his solo with that same squeal and brings the house down. That's Charles.
I went to English high school. We could come to school together and leave school together. We both were, you know, very, very interested in doing music. And during high school, we were able to protect each other.
And I remember Marie and I you know, going to support him whenever he played. Or prior to, like, when he was in high school, sneaking out at night to go and play in these clubs around Boston. Marie did not want that music thing for him, but he would sneak out. And sometimes I would be acting like he was in his room, going and talking to him, and Charles wasn't there, you know, he was gone.
Mom said, go get a degree. So I remember calling my mother at Brandeis going, you know, I'm not really feeling this thing, but I'm going to finish it anyway, just because I said I'm going to finish it. And so finishing Boston Latin gave me the resolve to finish Brandeis.
But when he graduated from Brandeis, he gave Marie his diploma. He says, here, this is what you wanted. Now I'm going to pursue what I want, his musical career. And he never looked back.
At college, Charles would spend hours shredding his scales. It's not fun work. I remember seeing him just really constantly working on them, always trying to hone his craft and make it better.
But the thing that I'm most proud of is not the awards, because the award happens in a moment. But the thing I'm most proud of is to be an inspiration to anyone about anything.
The world needs to know Charles Alexander, because he didn't come from the bright side of Boston. He worked himself up from the bottom side of it and rose to the top of it.
There's an adage among Black people that says, to be treated the same, you have to be twice as good. We just assume that. We call that the Black tax. You have to be spectacular to get high results. We all knew this, and we shattered expectations and went on to do things like what Charles has done.
When people look at me, that they get a sense that accomplishment is possible, achieving one's dreams is possible.
I think he's an educator, he's an entertainer. He's an impresario, he's an author, family man, an all-around good person. I couldn't do what Charles has done.
Charles's mother, God rest her soul, she is what he is made out of. You can't be regular, you can't use excuses, you can't use your skin as the reason why you don't achieve. She gave him spirit, she gave him drive.
I think of how fragile I looked to my mother every day that I walked out of the house, and she would always say, take care of yourself. And I was like, oh yeah, Mom, I got it. And now as a parent, I know how powerful those words are and how fragile I must have looked to her and how much work she had to do in order to make sure that her child was honored, valued, treated well.
Our headmaster, Wilfred L. O'Leary, used to say, work plus desire equals success. That would be Charles. That would totally be Charles. And so I am extremely happy for my friend. I'm extremely proud of my school.
I will tell anyone, anywhere on the planet, that Boston Latin School is directly responsible for shaping me as the human being that I am. The good of it and the bad of it. Because if you can survive that paradox of Boston and Boston Latin School being the best of America, but also showcasing some of the problematic issues of America, if you can survive that, then you can probably do well in this country.
It's my great pleasure to present this high honor to the alumnus responsible for creating some of the best jams on the soundtrack of my own high school career. I'll read the plaque as it's written here. The highest award of the Boston Latin School Association, proudly given to a most deserving son, Prince Charles Alexander, class of 1975, Distinguished Graduate of the Year. A recording artist originally signed with Virgin Records, whose distinguished career has flourished over four decades, embracing a variety of industry roles and transitions through musical genres. A highly sought after producer and engineer for some of the world's best-selling recording artists, with more than 40 platinum and gold certifications, 3 Grammy Awards, and accolades from the world over. A professor at Berklee College of Music and highly regarded educator who has taught internationally and in the US at prestigious institutions, including NYU's Clive Davis Institute of Recorded Music. A powerful industry influencer and member of the National Academy of Recording Arts and Sciences, Grammy Committee Board of Governors, the Recording Academy Producers and Engineers Wing, and the Audio Engineering Society. A mentor and generous benefactor to youth at BLS and beyond, inspired by an abiding belief in the ability of music to express the human condition and reflect cultural and societal issues. On this day, December 3rd, 2020.
I really appreciate this award, and I have to thank you, Rachel, you, Peter, Sean, and the BLS Award Committee. And on behalf of me, my family, my mom, who left the planet in 2008, I have to say that I'm elated at this award. It might be a small thing to some people. It's just your high school honoring you. Everybody's high school honors them. But BLS is a special place. 1635 is a long time ago. And we've got this unbroken string of successful people and contributions to culture. And I appreciate it being honored in this way by the committee. Thank you very much.
Hey, Dad. Congratulations on winning this award. I know how much Boston Latin means to you, and the stories you tell about your time there have been a huge inspiration for me. I'm so happy that we can all come together to celebrate your life and accomplishments today. I love you so, so, so much.
Congratulations, Charles, on being the 2020 Distinguished Graduate for Boston Latin School. We are so proud of you, and we know you worked very hard to get to this point. Thank you for allowing us to share it with you. Ready? Congratulations, Daddy. We love you. Bye.
When she said Charles, it was like the sun and the moon would both, you know, like, oh, she could say Charles the way nobody else could. She loved her some Charles, as we all, you know, we all do, you know. She would definitely, and I say to him each time he reaches another milestone in his incredible life, I said, yeah, Marie is smiling down on you, saying, Charles, I'm so proud of you.
Congratulations, Prince Charles. I have to say that having graduated from Boston Latin School, a Boston Latin school that produced someone like you, I'm enormously proud. You remind us of a fundamental truth about the school, and that's that when you combine the lessons that you learn there with hard work and grit and determination, and you have the love and the support of family and friends around you, you can achieve absolutely anything. So from everybody in the Boston Latin School community, I say thank you for inspiring us and giving us great pride in Boston Latin School. And Mr. Pitts, congratulations on your well-earned retirement. For 21 years, you have been making the corridors of Boston Latin School sing. And I'm grateful for what you have done to give us this pride in an aspect of Latin School that we've come to appreciate and to honor and to cherish as one of the great dimensions of the school that has really evolved over time. In your retirement, I wish you all the success that I wish for myself in my professional life. Let's both catch a lot of big fish. We all know that 2020 has been an incredibly challenging year, and that it's required us to be in our work and personal lives, flexible and adaptive, and we know that's been the case for the students and the faculty of Boston Latin School. We heard from them this evening, and I think we all came away from hearing those words with great confidence in what's happening at the school today and great confidence in what the school will be in the future. I'm personally grateful to Ms. Skerritt for her leadership, and I'm very grateful to the faculty for all that they do to make sure that the young students of Latin School succeed and achieve no matter what the adversity they face. And of course, none of the successes of Latin School are possible without the Boston Latin School Association, without all of you, parents and alumni and friends and benefactors who give hours of time in advocacy, volunteer service, and of course, in philanthropy. Without all of that, Latin School would not be what it is. On behalf of the students and faculty, I say thank you. We need you. Thanks for standing by us. So as we wrap up the evening, I invite you to stay with us for just a few minutes longer. You're going to have a chance to hear from some voices from across the Latin School generations. I invite you to look for your friends, your classmates, hear their words, their greetings, their inspiration. But before that, I take great pleasure in introducing you to one of the great lights of Latin School of recent years, a real vocal talent, now in her second year at Harvard from the class of 2019, Perrin Price, who will be singing Andra Day's Rise Up.
You're broken down and tired of living life on a merry-go-round, and you can't find the light of her, but I see it in you, so we gon' work it out. Ooh, mountains, we gon' work it out. Ooh, mountains, and I'll rise up, I'll rise like the day. I'll rise up, I'll rise unafraid. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. And I'll rise up, high like the waves. I'll rise up, in spite of the ache. I'll rise up, and I'll do it a thousand times again. For you, for you, for you, for you. Isn't quiet, and it feels like it's getting hard to breathe. And I know you feel like dying, but I promise you we'll bring the world to its feet. Move, mountains, bring it to its feet.